is Democracy Now!
Los hermanos y hermanos de Bolivia.
To my brothers and sisters of Bolivia, the whole world, I want to inform you from Loaca Inye, I'm here with the Vice President and Minister of Health, that I have decided after listening to my friends at Conalcom in the Bolivian Worker Center and also listening to the Catholic Church to resign my position as President.
Bolivia's first indigenous president, Evo Morales, has resigned following what he described as a military coup. Bolivia has been the scene of weeks of protests since a disputed election last month. We'll get the latest. Then we spend the rest of the hour with Senator Elizabeth Warren. On Friday, I co-moderated the first presidential forum on environmental justice at South Carolina State University. Warren talked about the climate crisis, shutting down pipelines, capitalism, and more. Speaking about racial injustice, do you think the order of the primary state should change? You have Iowa and New Hampshire, two of the whitest states in the country. And then we move to South Carolina with a very significant population of people of color. And it means the candidates spend so much of their time catering to those first two states. Overall, do you think that should change?
I'm just a player in the game on this one. And I am delighted to be in South Carolina.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Bolivia is in a state of political crisis after the longtime president, Evo Morales, resigned Sunday following what he described as a military coup. Bolivia has been the scene of weeks of protests since a disputed election last month. Morales announced his resignation in a televised address Sunday.
Los hermanos y hermanos de Bolivia.
To my brothers and sisters of Bolivia, the whole world, I want to inform you from Loaca Inye, I'm here with the Vice President and Minister of Health, that I have decided after listening to my friends at Conalcom in the Bolivian Worker Center and also listening to the Catholic Church to resign my position as President.
Morales spoke shortly after the Bolivian military took to the airwaves to call for his resignation. Bolivia's vice president also resigned Sunday, as did the head of the Bolivian Senate in the lower house. Opposition leader Jeanine Añez, who is the second vice president of the Bolivian Senate, is claiming she will assume the presidency today. We'll have more on the situation in Bolivia after headlines. In Brazil, former President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva was greeted by crowds of his supporters as he walked free from jail on Friday.
You have no idea of the significance for me to be here with you. I, who my whole life talked with the Brazilian people, never thought that today I could be here talking with men and women who during the past 580 days were here saying, good morning, Lula, good afternoon, Lula, yelling, good night, Lula, no matter if it was raining, if it was 40 degrees or 0 degrees. I want to tell you that from here I'm going to Sao Paulo. Tomorrow I have a meeting with the Metallurgical Union, and after, the doors of Brazil will be open for me to go around the country.
Lula's freedom came after the Brazilian Supreme Court ended mandatory imprisonment for people convicted of a crime who lost their first appeal. He'd been in prison for a year and a half after he's convicted of accepting a beachside apartment from an engineering firm vying for contracts at the state oil company Petrobras. Many of Lula's supporters say his conviction and jailing ahead of Brazil's 2018 presidential election, in which Lula was the frontrunner, was politically motivated. He denied the charges. His jailing cleared the way for the election of Brazil's far-right President Jair Bolsonaro. To see our full interview with Lula just before he was imprisoned, go to democracynow.org. In Syria, at least 8 people were killed in a bombing in the northeastern city of Tel Abyad. No one has claimed responsibility so far. Turkish troops seized the city from Syrian Kurdish fighters last month following President Trump's decision to withdraw U.S. military support for the Kurds, clearing the way for the Turkish offensive. Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan is planning to visit President Trump at the White House on Wednesday. The same day televised impeachment hearings begin, investigating whether President Trump withheld military aid from Ukraine in order to pressure the Ukrainian president to investigate Trump's political rival Joe Biden and his son. The first two witnesses will be William Taylor, the top American diplomat in Ukraine, and George Kent, a senior State Department official. Former U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations Nikki Haley says former White House Chief of Staff John Kelly and former Secretary of State Rex Tillerson told her to work against President Trump, reportedly saying they were trying to save the country. That's according to her new book, With All Due Respect. Haley also writes Tillerson told her people would die if Trump were allowed to govern unchecked. In Iraq, the death toll from ongoing anti-government protests has risen to at least 319 people, with another nearly 15,000 people injured. That's according to the Iraqi Parliamentary Human Rights Committee, which has been tracking the government's bloody repression of protests in Baghdad, Basra, Nasiriyah, and other cities. The demonstrations erupted over a month ago over unemployment, corruption, and the lack of basic services, such as water and electricity. In Hong Kong, two people are in critical condition as anti-government protests escalated today. Police shot a student protester at close range. The shooting was captured in a video that has since gone viral. A pro-Beijing supporter was doused in flammable liquid and burned after an argument with protesters. Pro-democracy protesters have called for a general strike today. At least 20 people have died in Bangladesh and India as Cyclone Bulbul ravaged parts of the coast on Saturday with winds of up to 75 miles per hour. The cyclone forced over 2 million people to evacuate their homes in Bangladesh. Meanwhile, in Australia, the island's most populous state has declared a state of emergency as authorities warn of catastrophic fire risk. Dozens of fires are burning across New South Wales. Three people have died so far. Authorities are warning that this week could, quote, be the most dangerous bushfire week this nation has ever seen. Hundreds of koala bears have also perished in the fires. Germans gathered Saturday to mark the 30th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. The wall separated communist East Germany from capitalist West Germany. It was one of the most prominent symbols of the Cold War. After its fall, Germany reunited in 1990. Meanwhile, thousands of miles away, hundreds of people gathered Saturday to protest the construction of a different wall, Trump's border wall, which is slated to cut through the Oregon Pipe Cactus National Monument deep in the Sonoran Desert. The wall's construction is expected to destroy sites sacred to the Tohono O'odham Nation, a Native American nation whose territory is already separated by the U.S.-Mexico border. In Seattle, Washington, Socialist City Council member Kshama Savant has declared victory in a re-election race against her that pitted her against Amazon, Seattle's largest private employer and one of the largest companies in the world. Amazon backs Savant's opponent, Egon Orion, with nearly $500,000. Overall, Amazon poured $1.5 million into Seattle City Council election. But over the weekend, Savant declared victory as later vote counts showed her pulling ahead of Orion. Savant is Seattle's first socialist politician elected in nearly a century. She successfully pushed a number of progressive policies, including making Seattle the first major American city to adopt a $15-an-hour minimum wage. And in San Francisco, public defender Chesa Boudin has been declared the winner of the district attorney's race. Boudin is the child of Weather Underground activists Kathy Boudin and David Gilbert. He learned the news that he'd won the race by a razor-thin margin while he was on the plane flying back from visiting his father in prison in New York. Boudin ran on a platform of ending cash bail and dismantling the war on drugs. Some San Francisco leaders had accused the Police Officers Association of trying to buy the district attorney race, accusing the Officers Association of spending up to $650,000 on ads attacking Boudin. This is Chesa Boudin speaking on Democracy Now! Ahead of the election.
Being a progressive prosecutor, Amy, is not just about decarceration, reducing racial disparities, and so on. It's also about making sure we are using the tremendous power and discretion of the district attorney's office to enforce the laws equally. That means prosecuting corporate landlords when they commit fraud, It means prosecuting police when they commit murder or perjury. It means prosecuting corporations when they dump toxic waste into our communities, as they did in the Hunters Point shipyards. And it means having a broader vision of using the district attorney's office to actually keep our communities safe, not simply wage a racist war on drugs.
To see our full interview with Chesa Boudin, now the newly elected district attorney of San Francisco, go to democracynow.org. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. Bolivia is in a state of political crisis after longtime President Evo Morales resigned Sunday following what he described as a military coup. Bolivia has been the scene of weeks of protests since a disputed election last month. Morales announced his resignation in a televised address Sunday.
Las hermanas y hermanos de Bolivia.
To my brothers and sisters of Bolivia, the whole world, I want to inform you from Loaca Inye. I'm here with the Vice President and Minister of Health, that I have decided after listening to my friends at CONALCOM in the Bolivian Worker Center and also listening to the Catholic Church to resign my position as president.
President Morales spoke shortly after the Bolivian military took to the airwaves to call for his resignation.
After analyzing the internal conflict situation, we asked the president of the state to renounce his presidential mandate, allowing for peace to be restored and the maintenance of stability for the good of Bolivia.
Bolivia's vice president also resigned Sunday, as did the head of the Bolivian Senate and lower house. The top two officials on Bolivia's Supreme Electoral Court have been detained. Opposition leader Jeanine Añez, who is the second vice president of the Bolivian Senate, is claiming she will assume the presidency today. Evo Morales was Bolivia's first indigenous leader, was credited with lifting nearly a fifth of Bolivia's population out of poverty since he took office in 2006. But he faced criticism from some of his former supporters for running for a third and then a fourth term. Evo Morales's whereabouts are now unknown. His home was ransacked Sunday. Mexico's offered Morales asylum. Hours before resigning, Morales had agreed to call for new elections after the Organization of American States issued a report claiming there was, quote, clear manipulation in last month's election results. According to the official results of last month's election, Morales won 47% of the vote and just narrowly avoided a runoff election. But the OAS immediately questioned the election process, sparking mass street protests. Critics of the OAS say the global body did not provide any evidence of actual vote rigging. We go now to Washington, D.C., where we're joined by Mark Weisbrot, co-director of the Center for Economic and Policy Research. His latest piece for The Nation headlined, "The Trump Administration's Undercutting Democracy in Bolivia." Talk about the latest developments, the resignation of President Evo Morales, the first indigenous president of Bolivia.
Well, this is a military coup. There's no doubt about it now after the head of the military told the president and vice president to resign, and then they did. And I think it's really terrible the way it's been presented, because from the beginning, you had that OAS press release the day after the election, which hinted or implied, actually, very strongly, that there was something wrong with the vote count. And they never presented any evidence at all. They didn't present it in that release. They didn't present it in their next release. They didn't present it in their preliminary report. And there's really nothing in this latest so-called preliminary audit that shows that there was any fraud in this election. But it was repeated over and over again in all the media. And so it became kind of true. And, you know, if you look at the media, you don't see anybody, you don't see any experts, for example, saying that there was something wrong with the vote count. It's really just that OAS observation mission, which was under a lot of pressure, of course, from Senator Rubio and the Trump administration to do this, because they've wanted for some time to get rid of this government.
And explain how the election went. Morales stopping the election count, resuming it, and then what kind of majority he needed to avoid a runoff.
Okay, so this is very important because this has been very badly described, I think, in most of the media. You have a quick count, which is not even the official count. of the election, and it's not binding. It's not it's not what determines the result. It's just something that is done while the votes are being counted to let people know what's going on at that time. And so the quick count was interrupted. And when it resumed, and it was interrupted with Abel leading by about 7 percentage points, and when it came back, his margin increased. And if you read the press here, any of the articles, it's reported as though something terribly suspicious happened. He didn't have enough votes. He needed a 10-point margin in order to a 10-point lead over the next runner-up in order to win in the first round. And he didn't have that when the vote count, this quick count was interrupted, or the reporting was interrupted, I should say. And then, you know, he got it in the last 16% of the votes counted. He reached 10%. But if you look at what was really, so this was reported as a very suspicious thing. And this is what's reported over and over again to make it look like something was wrong. But if you look at it, actually the whole vote count, you see there was a steady trend of Evo's margin increasing almost from the beginning. And it didn't change in the last 16%. It just continued because, and you can look at the areas that were coming in, these were rural and poor areas where Evo Morales had more support. That's all that happened. This happens in elections. You can see this if you watch election returns in the U.S. There was never anything there.
Several Latin American leaders have criticized the ouster of Evo Morales in Bolivia. This is Argentina's president-elect Alberto Fernandez.
What's happening in Bolivia is that there's a dominant class that will not resign themselves to losing power to the hands of a president who is the first Bolivian president that looks like Bolivians. That's what's happening.
And British Labour leader Jeremy Corbyn tweeted Sunday to Morales, who, along with a powerful movement, has brought so much social progress forced from office by the military, is appalling. I condemn this coup against the Bolivian people and stand with them for democracy, social justice and independence. So if you can talk, Mark Weisbrot, about the role of the Bolivian military and what about the Trump administration?
Well, I think the most, the Bolivian military very clearly said, I mean, before they did that, they said they weren't going to intervene in terms of the protest. But they very clearly, the head of the armed forces said that Evo should resign right before he did that. And so it was a military coup. And Evo Morales is calling it that, of course. And there isn't any doubt about it. The media hasn't really mentioned it as much as a military coup. But it definitely is. In terms of the Trump administration, you can look at tweets and statements from Marco Rubio right before the votes were even counted, saying that there was going to be fraud and, making it clear that they didn't want this government to be there. And so, yeah, I think that, I mean, it's very obvious that they supported this coup. And it's very obvious that they pressured the OAS, where, the United States supplies 60% of the budget. And, this is the problem. The media treats this OAS as though it's really an independent arbiter here. And they do have electoral missions. And most of the time, they're clean. But they are not always. And, in Haiti in 2011, for example, they reversed the results of a first-round presidential election without any statistical test, recount, or any reason. It was completely political. And in 2000, they reversed their position, their report on the election, when the United States, as you know and you've reported on this show, wanted to cut off all international aid to Haiti and spent 4 years preparing for the coup of 2004. So the OAS played a major role in that by changing their report on the election in Haiti. And so I think this is a kind of a classic military coup supported by the United States.
So, Mark Weisbrot, you have the CIA involvement in coups in Bolivia in 1952, in 1964, 1970, 1980. Would you add 2019 to that list?
I would add it to the list. I mean, we don't have the hard evidence of what they did. You know, it's not like 2009 in Honduras, where Hillary Clinton wrote in her memoirs that she worked in the OAS, too, to prevent the elected president, who you've had on this show, from coming back to the country and to the presidency. But I think we'll probably find out more later. But it is very obvious that they supported this coup.
Earlier today, Evo Morales tweeted, "The coup perpetrators who attacked my house and my sisters, who threatened to kill ministers and their kids, who humiliated a mayor, are now lying and trying to blame us for the chaos and violence they created. Bolivia and the world are witnesses to this coup." Among those who condemn the coup are Lula. Yes, the Brazilian former president, President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva, also big news. And we just have 30 seconds. But if you, Mark, can talk about the significance of his release from prison after a year and a half. He had been the front runner in the election before he ultimately was imprisoned. Now he's out. What does this mean?
Well, this is definitely a victory. But the thing that I worry about most is they could arrest him at any time for any reason. You have the so-called justice minister of the country, who is the judge who put him in prison and in a trial that really almost everyone now knows was lacking in evidence and was really a political trial. And so, and you have I don't know how else to say it, but a fascistic government. So he is definitely in danger, and there's going to be a need to, you know, really defend him.
Well, I want to thank you very much for being with us. Of course, we'll continue to follow these developments. Mark Weisbrot, co-director of the Center for Economic and Policy Research, speaking to us from Washington, D.C. The president of Bolivia, Evo Morales, resigned yesterday, saying he was ousted by a military coup. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, the first ever presidential forum on environmental justice. It's held in South Carolina. I co-moderated. Today, we play you our segment with Elizabeth Warren.
Ser tu bravura, ser la fuerza y juventud. De tu letargo mudo la voz de inquietud. Bolivia.
Después de siglo y medio de humillación,
Bolivia.
Bolivia by Los Harcas. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. On Friday night, the first-ever presidential forum on environmental justice was held at South Carolina State University in Orangeburg. Six Democratic presidential candidates took part. Senators Elizabeth Warren and Cory Booker, Tom Steyer, Marianne Williamson, John Delaney and Joe Sestak. I co-moderated the event with Mustafa Ali, former official with the Environmental Protection Agency, vice president of the National Wildlife Federation. We'll be airing highlights of the forum in the coming weeks, but today we turn to Senator Elizabeth Warren. Mustafa Ali began the questioning.
Many communities of color, low-income communities, and indigenous populations are literally dying for a breath of fresh air. We have 100,000 people who are dying prematurely from air pollution in our country. Communities like the Manchester community in Houston, Texas, to Cancer Alley running between Baton Rouge and Louisiana, or even here in Charleston, South Carolina. What would you do to address the epidemic that's happening in our communities from air pollution?
So part of it is we need to strengthen the Environmental Protection Agency. Here's a radical notion. How about if we don't have a coal lobbyist to head up the EPA? You think that's a good starting place? But it is. As they have tried to roll back the Trump administration and the EPA, under his administration have tried to roll back air quality standards. We need to go in the other direction. We need to roll forward. And so we need to be much stronger in this. But can I add a second part to that? Because I think it's really important. And that is, I want to bring in the CDC. I want to treat this as the public health emergency that it is. Yeah. If people were dying of a mysterious virus, if it were cutting lives short in well-to-do communities, you better believe that we'd be coming in with the research, we'd be highlighting where the problems are, and we'd be figuring out how to fix them and to fix them fast. Instead, we just watch over and over and over how children who live in poor communities, who live in communities of color, have higher rates of hospitalization for asthma. Why? Because what they burn in Ohio, you breathe in Massachusetts, and it's hard on our children. Because our children are the most vulnerable, and they live next to the places that are the dirtiest, that have the worst air. So I actually want to treat this, I want to come in aggressively and treat this like the public health emergency that it is. I want the scientists on it, and I want to put the real resources behind fixing it.
Thank you.
Tom Steyer said he would declare a state of climate emergency the first day he were president. Would you do the same?
We could. You know, here's how I think of this. I want to use the tools available as president. And the way I think of using the tools, I want to think about what, I love saying this, a president can do all by herself. And the way I think of that is part of what I mentioned here. What I want to do is I want to make a position in the White House that is a permanent, ongoing position to address the injustices that we currently face on this issue. So for me, what I have committed to do is both to create a position in the White House, and in the first 100 days, not just to do it all by myself on this one, but to ask the groups that have been on the front lines to be part of this, to come together and to start putting together an action plan. And the reason I say that is when we're talking about the question of environmental justice, it's a highly localized problem. You need national muscle. You need national money. You need a national will to get in there and fix the problem. But you don't need someone at the national level saying, here's the right answer. Because the answer is different. It's different on tribal lands out west than it is in sinking cities near the coast. It is different to be near a dump that smolders and burns than it is to be near a factory that continues to put poisons into the water. And so for each of those, the way I see this is you make the concrete commitment on finances, you make the concrete commitment on bringing people together, and then you ask the communities to identify what needs to be done. And then if I can, the third part is we have to look at this holistically. It's not just about cleaning up the dumps. It's not just about making the factories either filter what they're putting into the air and the water or shutting down. It's also about lifting these communities up, because these communities have been damaged for generation after generation. So it's about investments, which I'd love to talk about, in housing. It's about economic investments, investments in schools. It's about making the investments in these communities so we go from communities that, as you say, are literally killing people to communities that are actually thriving. That's what I want to see.
Where do you stand? Not
just on the Dakota Access Pipeline being built. It has been now, and it's operating at a great capacity. But now the Standing Rock sewer in court, they're saying a proper environmental impact statement wasn't done, and that the Dakota Access Pipeline should be shut down. Do you agree with this? What would you do as president, both on Dakota Access Pipeline, the Keystone XL that President Trump greenlighted, and pipelines overall across the country?
So let me start by saying I believe we ought to enforce our environmental laws. And when the appropriate environmental impact statements have not been done, then yes, we should shut down the operations. That's what it means to have these laws, is that we enforce these laws. But if I can, I want to add an extra piece, because I think this really brings in the question of tribal governance and tribes' abilities to be the good stewards of their land. I have already made a very public commitment to the tribes, both to honor that the tribes themselves make the decision about what happens on tribal lands. This is a nation-to-nation relationship. This is about our trust and treaty obligations. But I go a step further, and to say on federal lands that abut tribal lands, that as president, I will not approve any drilling, mining pipelines that abut those lands, on these federal lands, that abut the tribal lands, unless the tribes that are affected give their own informed consent in advance. I believe that they will be the good stewards of the land, and I believe they will protect the region.
Are you for the shutting down of the Dakota Access Pipeline?
And how would you better protect? You know, we have this shrinking of our federal lands. You know, they have opened it up to mining and drilling and all these other types of things. What would you do as president to better protect our federal lands?
Well, like I said, this is one a president can do all by herself. And on day one, I will say no new drilling, no new mining on our federal lands, and no offshore drilling. You just shut it down. And, you know, that's actually a pretty big impact because, as you know, about a quarter of our lands are federally protected lands. And right now, this is really this fundamental question, who government works for. So right now, the mining companies, the drilling companies that want to make big dollars by basically getting drilling rights and mining rights for pennies on the dollar and leaving behind waste for not only local communities to have to deal with, for the tribes to have to deal with, but destroying pristine lands for generations to come. I believe that we have both a strong economic, I'll start there, obligation, but also a strong moral obligation to protect our public lands and make sure they remain safe. I have fought the Trump administration's efforts to try to undo protection of our federal lands, and I will be a careful protector of those lands. You know, I'll just add on this. I know we talk about the huge ramifications. For me, it's also personal. My husband and I are hikers. We've hiked many of these federal lands for decades now. And when we were hiking not long ago, we were talking about what it would mean if our grandchildren won't come and see what we see. If our grandchildren will be denied the opportunity to come out and see some of the greatest beauties on this earth. We have an obligation to future generations. It's not about what they will inherit. It's about what we are borrowing from them. And we must meet that obligation. We must meet it because it is right for our country, because it is right for this world, but also because it is morally right. We need to live our values.
Do you think Tom Perez, the chairman of the Democratic National Committee, is wrong to say no to a debate specifically on the climate crisis?
Yes.
How can you
prevail upon him and the DNC to change their minds?
I've already weighed in on this one quite publicly and asked for a climate debate. Obviously, I haven't prevailed on that. But I did this many months ago because I think this is the urgent issue of our time. You know, I don't have to say it to you, but it is worth repeating every chance we get, that climate change threatens every living thing on this planet, and that everything else we talk about depends on our having an Earth that we can live on for generations to come. So I think as Democrats, we should be happy to get together to lift this issue. As I said, I'm happy to be here now in this forum to lift this issue for people all around the country and all around the world. The United States is a leader on climate. We are. Right now, we're just leading in the wrong direction. We need to show that that's not all of America. That is not who we are as Americans. That we treasure this land and we treasure this planet, and we're willing to put real resources behind protecting it.
Well, Senator Warren, we know that communities of color, frontline communities, are hit first and worst from climate change. From Puerto Rico, where we lost over 3,000 lives, to Princeville, North Carolina, founded by freed slaves, and have had to deal with these devastating floods. We used to talk about 50-year floods. Now we're talking about 100-year floods and 500-year floods, all the way, of course, to what happened in New Orleans from Katrina. So we asked the previous candidate who was sitting in the chair that you are, what would be your boldest move on climate change? Mm-hmm. What would be yours?
$1 trillion.
That seems pretty bold.
This is important. This is why I said I think it's important to have specifics around this. And it's really easy to say, I've got a, for someone, a candidate, to say, here's a big climate plan. And oh, yeah, we'll think about environmental justice somewhere along the way and get it and say the right things. But somehow in the decision making, it just never happens. I don't want to be that president. I want to be a president who commits in advance and says, we know we have a serious problem here. So I've got a plan to put about $3 trillion into climate remediation, direct dollars out of the federal government, a lot of leverage out of that. What I do is I commit to take a third of that and say, we're going to spend it on environmental justice. We're going to spend it on going to the communities that are hit first, that are hit hardest, that have been hit the longest, generation after generation. As I said, I don't want to dictate from Washington what it takes. You know, it may be a seawall in one place. It may be a sandbar in a different one. It may be relocation in some. You hate to say it, but it may be. There are all kinds of differences in how it should happen. And that's the respect for the communities and for the community groups that have been fighting this for so long. But the role of the federal government is to protect. The role of the federal government is to provide the resources. The role of the federal government is to make sure that as a country, we leave no communities behind.
Let me just follow up real quickly on that. Mm-hmm. And I appreciate what you're sharing with us. But the reality is that there are some states that have not had the best relationship with our most vulnerable communities. Mm-hmm. So if we have $1 trillion, $2 trillion, $3 trillion on the federal level, how will we ensure on the state level that they do the right things to address the impacts that are happening in our communities?
It's a good question. So let me do this both ways. On the federal dollars, they don't have to go to the states. You can make the federal dollars go straight to the communities so that communities have the ability to come in and say, here's our problem. We qualify for federal funds, so you don't have a governor or state legislature in between sucking up that money that comes in buckets and ends up being distributed to some communities with an eyedropper. That's part one. But the second part, I think, is you are right. We need states to have their own environmental laws. We should do this at the federal level, but we need environmental enforcement at the state level and environmental rules that are appropriate to those states. I think the best way we make that happen is when we strengthen the groups on the ground. So think of it as an action like this. When you've got a federal government, when you've got a president who is really committed on environmental issues, and you've got a lot of local groups that both have the ability to get to funding, have the ability to make a difference in their communities, that strengthens those groups. That strengthens those communities. And that gives them a lot more muscle to deal with state governments that may otherwise have overlooked them.
We'll be back with presidential candidate Senator Elizabeth Warren in 30 seconds.
There are cockles and broken glass spread across the floor. Door is wide open and the sand matrix all down the hall. Broken panes in the window reflected light in from the sky.
This is no Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the War and Peace Report. I'm Mimi Goodman. As we continue our coverage of the first ever Presidential Forum on Environmental Justice, held Friday night in South Carolina at South Carolina State University, former EPA official Mustafa Ali and I questioned Democratic Senator Elizabeth Warren.
Senator Warren, you've said a crucial distinction between you and Bernie Sanders is that you're a capitalist and he's a socialist. Many activists, though, say that an economic system based on perpetual growth is fundamentally at odds with a stable, clean, and sustainable environment. How do you reconcile this?
So, you know, the way I see this, I believe in markets. I think markets bring us a lot of innovation, a lot of creation, a lot of change that's good. I want to see, for example, markets for clean, not just clean energy, but how we're going to clean the carbon out of the air, how we're going to clean the filth out of the water. But understand this, markets without rules are theft. They're theft. It allows, whenever you get a chance, when you have a market that people get to, corporations get to cheat people, that's theft. That's not a market. And that's not how markets are supposed to operate. So my efforts for many years now have been about how we get those markets to function so that we get the best out of the markets, but that people don't get cheated. And maybe the best example of that is in the early 2000s, I'll just give you an example. I'm not going to start with my toaster story. I'll just start it with mortgages. Mortgages were so dangerous and so complex that someone who got a mortgage had a 1 in 5 chance of losing their home over that mortgage, not through a fire, but through foreclosure. Communities of color were targeted for the worst of the worst mortgage. And the government, they weren't on the side of the people. They were deep in the pockets of the big banks. In fact, so deep that they let the big banks sell enough of those mortgages to crash the entire economy. So after that crash, I had an idea. And the idea was for a consumer agency that would come in just like a consumer agency that protects you from buying toasters that would burst into flames, a consumer agency that would protect people who are buying mortgages and credit cards and student loans and be on the side of the consumer. And people told me, don't even try to do it because you never get it passed. The big banks will stop you, big money, the Republicans, and frankly, a whole bunch of the Democrats. But it was the right thing to do. So I got in that fight. A bunch of consumer groups helped out in that fight. And we took on Wall Street. We took on the big money. And President Obama signed that agency into law in 2010. It has now, yes. And here's the thing. It has now forced those financial institutions to return more than $12 billion directly to people who were cheated. Yep. Now, we know how to make government work for the people. And that means you got to have rules. I don't want to get rid of those devices. I don't want to get rid of credit cards. I kind of like my credit card. I just don't want them to be able to cheat me or anyone else. For me, that's what this is all about.
Can I follow up?
Sure.
Ask you to respond to two different men. Bernie Sanders says there should be no billionaires. Do you agree with that?
No.
Why not?
Look, somebody has a great idea, and they follow it through, and they work hard, and they build something. Good for them. But here's my pitch. You built a great fortune in this country. Good for you. But you built it, at least in part, using workers. All of us help pay to educate. You built it, at least in part, getting your goods to market on roads and bridges. All of us help pay to build. You built it, at least in part, protected by police and firefighters. All of us help pay their salaries for. So here's my view. You make it to the top, to the tip top, then the answer is pay a wealth tax so that we can invest and create opportunities for everyone else. That's what my 2 cent wealth tax is all about.
The second man I want you to respond to is Mark Zuckerberg, right?
Yeah.
CEO of Facebook, who said that a Warren presidency would suck for his company. That was in an audio leak that came out.
Boo-hoo.
Which brings me to the Climate Accountability Institute, which said the world's wealthiest corporations are most responsible for the climate crisis, which, of course, impacts most people of color and poorest communities. More than 70% of global emissions come from just 100 companies.
Right.
What do you think should be done to challenge this, change this? What would you do as president? Well, and what are you doing as senator?
Well, part one is we could regulate it. Look, three industries. We put serious regulations in place and say there can't be any new buildings, any new homes built after 2028, zero carbon emission. 2030, zero carbon emission on all automobiles and light trucks produced. And by 2035, zero carbon emission on all electric production. Three industries. We can cut carbon emission in the United States of America by 70%. Three industries. So there's one of your tools, is regulation, right there. You've got to be willing to come in on the regulation. But let me make another point about this. Understand, those giant companies you're talking about, yeah, they do a lot of terrible things. But they also have a lot of power. And they exercise that power. They exercise that power over their workers. They exercise it over their customers, over the communities where they're located, and over the government in Washington. That is corruption, pure and simple. And we need to call it out and fight back. What I want to do on the first day as president, the legislation I want to push through is anti-corruption legislation. I want to get in there and fight the oil companies, the big polluters. Because here's the deal. Anybody who comes up here and tells you about their climate plans, who doesn't have an anti-corruption plan, who doesn't have a plan to beat back the influence of money in Washington, is not serious. Oh, we'll end up with a plan that has some great name like cleaned up the entire world and it's now full of unicorns and butterflies. But what it will really do is continue to carve out enough exceptions that the profits keep flowing to the same people who are getting those profits right now. So I'm out there to fight this corruption. That has to be step number one, is to go after them.
Should corporate executives who pollute go to jail?
If they do harm to people, they need to be held responsible. And I actually have a bill already on this. You shouldn't be able to walk away from the injuries you create. No one should be able to do that in the United States. We've got a problem right now in this country, and the problem we've got is too much power is concentrated in the hands of the wealthy and the well-connected, and they are using it every single day to keep Washington exactly where they want it. You know, It's not only what Donald Trump has done in the Environmental Protection Agency, it's decades of this. People talk about a Washington that doesn't work. Puh, Washington works great if you're rich. Washington works great if you run a giant corporation. Understand, when this administration wanted to get something done, tax cuts for their big donors, you know how long it took them? 5 weeks. They went behind closed doors with their big donors and the lobbyists, scribbled out the bill and passed it, and $1.5 trillion went out the door, mostly to giant corporations and rich people. They know how to get something done. When nothing is getting done on climate, when nothing is getting done on gun safety, when nothing is getting done on the cost of prescription drugs, ask yourself who benefits from that. Right? It's the gun industry. It's the polluters. It's the drilling industry. It's the pharmaceutical industry. They are getting the Washington they want. What 2020 is all about is it's time for us to get the Washington that works for the people, not the one that just works for the big corporations.
Yeah. Senator Warren, we're going to go to a question from one of our students.
Sure.
So if Vladimir Haines could come forward and pose your question to Senator Warren.
It's good to see you.
Hello, how are you?
I'm good.
Vladimir Haines. My question for you, Senator Warren, is how can you ensure that no community will be left behind when it comes to the fight of environmental injustice? And I am a junior agribusiness major as well as a member of the SCSU football team.
Whoa! What position do you play?
Fullback and tight end.
All right. It's good to see you. And it's a good question. I think the way we do that is we make specific commitments. We can't make environmental justice an afterthought. It has to be a part of our climate plan design from the beginning. So partly, this is why I talk about a commitment, a financial commitment that goes to the frontline and fence line communities. Partly, it's why I talk about the commitment to our Native American tribes and their dominion over not just their tribal lands, but the lands that are adjacent to them, because that's what it takes to protect our earth. Partly, it's about attacking the health aspects, coming at this from a different perspective, so that we start to look at this as a public health problem and we lift that up. I think in each case, the more attention we can bring in the more directions, that's how we make sure that the communities that have been hardest hit are not left behind. This is why, as president, I want to make this a part of what I do in the White House. I don't want it something that people just come in. And by the way, I should add to that, I want to make it a part of what every agency does. So I want our agencies, I want our banking regulators to be thinking about climate risk. Think about that. I want them to be thinking about that. I want our Department of Labor to be thinking about what it means. The Trump administration has rolled back protections for people who work in dangerous areas, what they breathe, what kind of chemicals they're exposed to. I want each and every one of our departments to have someone at the top, near the top, who is thinking about the environmental impact of what happens, what that agency approves of, what that agency is responsible for, and what it means in the communities that are most affected. We need a lot of change, big change, but I believe we can do this together. This is one of these that's about leadership at the top, and it's about powerful communities at the grassroots all across this country. That's how we make change.
Senator Warren, just a quick question. So yeah. Many of our most vulnerable communities are being gentrified.
Yep.
They're being gentrified from the impacts from climate change. They're being gentrified by the guise of revitalization. What would you do about this displacement that is continuing to happen?
So can I just do this one? I'll start on housing, because this is the biggest area. We got a housing crisis in this country. Gentrification is certainly part of it, but think about it in a larger context. Two generations ago, Where was the source of new housing for working families, for the working poor, for the poor poor? Where was it? You had two places. One were private developers. They're not there anymore. They're not building that housing. They're building McMansions. And I'm not mad at them. That's where their profits are. But they've left the area. I grew up in a two-bedroom, one-bath little house. It was in the last row of last street in Norman, Oklahoma. The garage had been converted into a bedroom for my three brothers. Nobody's building that house anymore. They're not private developers. Second part is federal government that used to pump money into housing and has really largely backed out of that. So I have a plan for that, and that is to build about 3.2 million new housing units across America. We need more housing in America. And this is housing for working families. It's housing for the working poor. It's housing for the poor poor. It's housing for the homeless. It's housing for seniors who want to be able to age in place. It's housing for people with disabilities who need specially outfitted housing. It's housing for people who are returning from prison and who need a place to be able to live. We need to build more housing in this country. An independent analysis shows that my plan would reduce rents across the nation by about 10%. And what they do is they let people, we got to get these down into the communities. They let people stay in the communities. They let people have new housing in those communities, housing that they can afford and be part of. And then one other little part, when you're talking about housing, is the role that housing plays in wealth. You know, the number one savings plan in America is buy a house for middle-class families. Number one retirement plan, live in your house and try to pay it off and then live on your Social Security when you retire. It's the number one way that wealth is transmitted from one generation to the next. If grandma and grandpa can hold on to the house until they pass, there's something there for the kids and the grandkids and the great-grandkids. So it should be no surprise to you that for generations, the American government, the federal government, subsidized the purchase of housing for white people and discriminated against the purchase of housing for black people. It's called redlining. And it created a black-white wealth gap that continues even to this day because of the generational effects as well as what's happened in these communities. So my housing plan is not only about 3.2 million new housing units across this country, in little communities and big cities all across America. It also says we've got to stop and recognize the racial dimension of what happened here. So I have first-time home buyer assistance for people who live in formerly redlined communities and people who were targeted during the financial crash and lost their homes. So we give people a chance to get back on level footing. We can't keep passing these laws that are racially neutral on their face. We say, oh, same housing for everybody. We've got to acknowledge the past wrongs that are still felt today, the past official discrimination of the United States government that is still felt today, and we got to take steps toward making that right. And that's what my housing plan is.
Senator Warren, just 30 seconds left. But speaking about racial injustice, do you think the order of the primary state should change? You have Iowa and New Hampshire.
Wait, let me just, before you finish, are you actually going to ask me to sit here and criticize Iowa and New Hampshire?
No, I'm asking about the order.
No, that is what Iowa
and
New Hampshire
are all
about.
But let me just ask, they're two of the whitest states in the country. And then we moved to South Carolina with a very significant population of people of color. And it means the candidates spend so much of their time catering to those first two states. Overall, do you think that should change?
Look, I'm just a player in the game on this one. And I am delighted to be in South Carolina. Thank you.
Thank you so
Thank
much.
You, Senator.
It's good to see you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
2020 presidential candidate Senator Elizabeth Warren speaking at the first ever Presidential Forum on Environmental Justice Friday night. I co-moderated the forum with former EPA official Mustafa Santiago Ali. It was hosted by the NBCSL, that's the National Black Caucus of State Legislators. It took place at South Carolina State University in Orangeburg, site of the 1968 Orangeburg Massacre. Senator Cory Booker, Tom Steyer, Marianne Williamson, John Delaney, and Joseph also took part in the forum. Visit democracynow.org to see the full event. Share it with your friends on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Special thanks to Miriam Varner, Dennis Moynihan, John Hamilton, Libby Rainey, and Carla Wills. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us.